or what we call particulates. That's muck to you and me, dust. And all sorts of heavy metals which might be thrown out of the back of, say, a car exhaust fume, that sort of thing. And so these particulates and heavy metals fall upon the roof and they fall into the root zone, where they're taken up by the plants. A lot of plants have the ability to take up metals such as lead and store them in their tissues. So this is a good way, if you like, of locking up what would otherwise be a dangerous pollutant and which would go perhaps into a water system. It remains within the plant material. When the plant dies, that metal then just goes back into the root zone when the plant decomposes, and of course it will then be taken up by the next plant that grows there.
Carbon dioxide is another problem gas because it is a serious contributor to global warming. Fortunately, this gas can also be mopped up by these wondrous living roofs.
What the plant does is it absorbs carbon dioxide and it produces, by a sort of classic equation, where you take carbon dioxide and water, you produce glucose, and glucose molecules bonded together produce starch. And that is the energy which plants use, and it's the energy which we use when we eat plants. So when the plant eventually dies, CO2 is not just released again. You don't just get a puff of CO2 coming out, but you have carbon in a form which other things can use.
While green roofs are busy cleansing the air around us, they're also helping to keep our water safe. When the heavens open and rain pours onto the roof, the water has nowhere else to go but off onto the roads below. This runoff can pollute water bodies such as rivers and drinking water supplies as it washes debris along with it. In extremely heavy downpours, drainage systems can be overwhelmed by the volume of water, which can lead to flooding, as we saw all over the country earlier this year. Eco-roofs, however, can absorb the rainwater into their plants and the soil and store it. Here is 1 litre of rainwater falling on a tray planted up with sedum. This tray does not have an underlying waterproof layer like a normal green roof, so any rainwater not absorbed will drain out of the holes in the bottom to be collected. On a normal roof, the entire litre of water would have run straight off, but on our model green roof, only 100 millilitres wasn't absorbed. That's only 1/10 of the total rainwater. Therefore, the amount of runoff and possible water pollution is greatly reduced by just the soil and the plants on a green roof. By adding a waterproof layer underneath the soil, even more water would be contained on the roof and eventually reabsorbed into the atmosphere by evaporation. So while saturating our roofs with rainwater to help clean up our drinking water supplies is great, it can also help keep the house nice and quiet. The majority of us have to put up with some sort of outside noise intruding on our peace. But the extra layers of soil and vegetation on a green roof act as sound insulation, absorbing and reflecting sound waves away from the home. Studies show that a green roof can reduce sound levels by the same amount as 10 centimetres of concrete. That's a reduction of about 10 to 15 decibels, or from this volume to this.
So already, living roofs have proved their ability to increase biodiversity, improve people's health, purify the air and water supplies, and reduce noise pollution. And this is before even considering their main benefit to the environment, as they can save huge amounts of energy and slow the rate of global warming. The team here at London Zoo know how important it is to protect the environment and therefore introduce green roofs to their menagerie to lower their use of fuel.
These vibrant green systems keep buildings cool in the summer and warm in the winter, reducing the need for air conditioning and heating. This means less fuel is burnt and the amount of damaging gases released into the air are reduced.
Heat travels through material by moving from molecule to molecule. This is called conduction. The soil in a green roof, however, has air spaces between its particles, which makes it harder for heat to travel through. This works both ways, for heat from the sun trying to move into the building, and for heat in the building trying to escape.
Nottingham Trent University conducted a study to see how cool a green roof could keep a building over a hot summer. They measured the average temperature under a normal roof as 32 degrees centigrade, and the temperature under a neighbouring vegetated roof at 17 degrees centigrade. That
That's a huge 15 degrees cooler. For inhabitants who prefer to frolic in a rather more tropical climate, such as the Komodo dragons who live here, eco-roofs have proved rather useful. These frightening-looking reptiles are used to high temperatures of around 27 degrees centigrade, so the fantastic greenery on the roof of their home is perfect for keeping them toasty and warm.
Reducing your use of fuel, like London Zoo, is one way to fight global warming. Limiting heat emissions from buildings is another. Cities can have a temperature up to 11 degrees centigrade higher than surrounding countryside due to the urban heat island effect. This is where the hard surfaces of our roofs reflect heat back into the atmosphere, thereby increasing temperatures and global warming. Cities like New York suffer this effect and have therefore installed eco-roofs, like this one at Tribeca Green, to absorb heat into the soil and plants and then reuse it for evaporation. Living roofs also help to reduce heat loss from buildings, which would further contribute to global warming.
If you have this big fat insulating layer on, it's like you wearing a glove in wintertime. That prevents heat loss through the roof.
So with all these massive benefits, are there any drawbacks to these miracle roofs? Well, as always, it's the money problem. Current estimates for laying a green roof range from about £7 to £12 per square metre. However, when you consider that a green roof can extend a roof's life and save you a bundle on your fuel bills,
suddenly the initial cost doesn't seem so unreasonable. In fact, the money spent installing an eco-roof can actually be returned within a few years, thanks to all of these savings. So why aren't we all busy blanketing our cities in this glorious greenery? Well, at the moment, a few obstacles remain, such as a lack of funding or incentives from the government, and a limited public awareness. Many long-running campaigns have been putting pressure on the British government to remedy this, which are slowly proving successful.
Certainly in 2008, it's likely that there will be a legal framework in London called the Living Roofs Policy, which will mean there's an expectation on all developments to have green roofs.
In London alone, there is an area almost 200 times the size of Hyde Park that could feasibly be converted into living roof.
Meanwhile, large parts of Europe maintain multi-million pound businesses installing green roofs with funding and definitive policies from their governments. Both Washington and Boston have hosted conferences and award ceremonies for living roof innovation. And even Beijing is aiming for 45% green roof coverage by 2008 to counter their carbon dioxide outputs. But green roof activists hope this is just the beginning, as while one eco-roof makes a difference, the more roofs turn green, the greater the overall effect on a particular city or the planet as a whole. And so, in this age of global warming, it seems vital that the concrete tops of our cities are transformed into living, breathing, green roofs.